So at this point, there's literally thousands of reviews on YouTube for the latest Apple Silicon MacBooks. And if you're anything like me, then you've probably watched every single one of these, trying to work out whether these MacBooks are the right move for you. And it's confusing to navigate, right? Because they don't always do tests in the software that you use. I do a lot of work inside Fusion. It's my main motion graphics tool. And so when I got my hands on an Apple Silicon laptop, I wanted to find out how this laptop performed on timelines that had multiple compositions in them. I'm talking really custom, complicated node trees with a lot going on in them. Basically, I needed to know for us Fusion users, now that the dust has settled after all the reviews, does this laptop actually live up to the hype? Let's get into it. So here I've got the mid-tier 16-inch MacBook Pro. This is the M1 Pro version that sits in the middle on Apple's website, with the exception to one upgrade, which was bringing the RAM up to 32GB, just to bring it in line with Blackmagic's recommendations for Fusion. But it should be said that this might not be something that you have to do. You'll probably hear from other reviews that because the memory is unified, that you get a higher bandwidth, and so you get a bunch of speed benefits that you wouldn't otherwise get with a typical stick of RAM. So you might be able to save yourself £400 or $400 if you choose to just go with the specs that Apple have on their website already. I've personally got nothing to compare it to, so I can't really tell you whether or not that's a worthy upgrade, but I can show you how this one performs. So this right here is as real world as it gets. This is actually an edit that I've been working on for my day job, and it's got quite a lot going on. Now we're working on a 4K timeline, and I've got the render cache set to user. So the general purpose of this video was to show off some software that we developed, and I basically recreated all these different elements in Affinity and then brought it into Fusion. And if I go into Fusion just now, I could show you exactly how complicated this setup actually is. So you can see it here, this is a really large node tree and it's got a lot of stuff going on. But to break all this down, we're basically doing some 3D work on an image plane. All of this part of the node tree here is basically this app window here. And we've also got some custom text animations going on as well. So there's a lot happening here. Now, are there ways that I could simplify this? Absolutely. But I've kind of done this as a stress test here, just so you can see how all of this functions. This doesn't play back in real time in Fusion. We're definitely getting some lagged frames there. And it's not ideal, but it's definitely good enough to get some work done. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to reset the color of the user interface here, and I'm going to jump back into the edit page, and I'm going to turn off rendering just so you can see how that plays back. And yeah, it's not playing back well at all. We're getting like 1 to 1.5 frames at the moment on that, so real-time playback on a 4K Fusion clip like this is just not going to be possible. Clearly, we need to let this render through, so I'm going to go back in and I'm going to turn on user rendering here. And at the moment, let's just time this so that we can see how long this is actually going to take to render. Okay, so yeah, you can see this isn't exactly quick, but once we have it rendered, it does play back flawlessly after that. So the fans aren't kicking in at any point here, and this isn't hot by any means. So to me, it seems like once we bring whatever we're working on in Fusion into the edit page and let that render through, the chip is no longer working with real-time motion graphics. It's basically dealing with a ProRes file at that point. Everything works fine after that. Those video encoders will kick in and start to do a lot of the heavy lifting for us. Just to give you a better idea of how this performs, I'm going to do another example here. So I've got some 3D text and I've created this inside a 3D space where we've got some lighting effects going on. I didn't spend too long refining this, so it's just another example for us. But I've animated this text to drop in from the top of the screen and then to bounce and float about after that. And again, we'll let that play back in Fusion. Slow, but again, fast enough to make a decision about what we want to do with this. So I'm going to say change the color of the text. On the edit page, it's a little bit better than what we had before, but again, we're going to have to render this through, right? So we'll let it render through again. And then yeah, we get smooth playback after that point. So generally speaking, you're probably going to have to do a bit of rendering from time to time. If you're doing work in Fusion, it seems like it needs that time just to process things and get it to a point where it's going to be easy for the chip to play back. But one of the most impressive things is how quick this is actually doing this. Now, I film almost everything that I do on the Sony a7S III, which I'm filming with right now. And if you're familiar with Sony cameras, then you'll know that the file formats you get out of them aren't always the easiest to work with. In fact, on my last MacBook Pro, which was a 2019 Intel-based Mac, it would really, really struggle just to play those back without making any proxies. It honestly sounded like the computer was going to take off. But with this, I don't have to do any of that. I've not had to create proxies. I've not had to work on a lower resolution timeline. I can just work freely. I can edit, I can color grade, and there's been no hiccups so far. So again, I think it's those encoders that are doing most of the heavy lifting here. But when it comes to motion graphics on Fusion though, I think your mileage might vary. It's certainly good enough to get the job done, but you just shouldn't expect any immediately smooth playback. It does take a little bit of time to play catch up. Overall though, the power of this MacBook is amazing, and it's head and shoulders above the last MacBook that I used. But the performance isn't actually what I've been most impressed by when it comes to this machine, and that brings me nicely onto our next point. So with the 16-inch, we actually have one of the biggest batteries that Apple have ever done. And because the M1 Pro chip is the less power hungry of the two chip options, this is, technically speaking, the best battery life that you could get in an Apple laptop. So I wanted to test this out properly the other day when I got into work. So I made a note of the time when I got into the office, and I also made a note of the percentage that my battery was at, which was at 63%. So I had the screen brightness up to 100%, and I did nothing but edit the whole morning on battery power. And I went just over 3 hours before I had to plug the laptop back in, and even then it still had about 7% juice left in it. It's honestly so cool to be able to just sit on the sofa, chill out and do my work from there. And it's honestly just changed how I approach and edit altogether. And that brings me on to my last point that I want to make about this laptop, and that's portability. I actually think, ironically, the bigger MacBook, the 16-inch, is the better laptop for portability. And I've very nearly got the 14-inch of this, but now that I've got the 16-inch, I am so glad that I got that instead. So take this with a pinch of salt, because I've had a 16-inch laptop for a while now, but I actually don't personally think this is a big laptop. It fits in my camera bag, even though it's thicker than its predecessor. It's not cumbersome in the slightest, and it's really easily carried about. It does have a little bit of weight to it, but you wouldn't really call it heavy either. And so I think this is actually a perfect size. Resolve's user interface is already quite cramped. There's a lot of stuff in there, and that is especially true if you're working inside a Fusion. If you were to go with the 14-inch model and try and squeeze all of that interface into a smaller screen, you're probably going to be less inclined to use it as a laptop. You're probably going to want to dock it and have it plugged into a monitor, which in my opinion just totally defeats the purpose of having that small form factor in the first place. There's also the fact that the battery's smaller on the 14-inch as well, so you'd technically be getting less editing time when you're on the go. Okay, so should you invest in this laptop? I use the word invest deliberately here because these are not cheap. This version, even without the RAM upgrade, will still cost you a pretty hefty $2,599 from Apple. And so it's not a cost that I think anyone should consider lightly. Having said that, there is a lot to love here. You're getting ports back, you've got a great new keyboard and an amazing display. To me, the M1 Pro with the 32GB upgrade is kind of the Goldilocks machine. It lasts for a long time on battery, and it's basically going to handle anything that you throw at it video-wise. And as for the motion graphics in Fusion, yeah, there's a bit of a wait time, but you can see that it's still handled that pretty well. Now, as well as the occasional tech review, I also make tutorials on Affinity and DaVinci Resolve. So if that is your thing, then consider subscribing. And if you like this video, then give it a thumbs up. And I'll see you in the next one.